call the meeting to order of the Higher Education and Career Readiness Policy and Finance Committee. Welcome, everybody, to day two. Thank you for being here again, even if you, well, anyway, I'd like to start by, we have some minutes to approve today. So I made a motion.
I have a correction after it's moved.
You have a correction?
Or a question on the minutes.
Okay.
So it looks like we called the meeting to order twice. I don't know if you want that reflected on the minutes. And also, I don't know if we need to add Representative Pawlowski's addition to change in the rules on the minutes. I didn't know.
Explain where it's stored, time?
Looks like we called the meeting to order. I mean, it's noted at the top and in the, after the roll.
I think that's just the way the minutes are written.
Okay.
Do I have a motion? Are you making the motion to approve the minutes?
What about we don't need to add the Representative Pawlowski's correction?
No.
So I move the minutes.
Okay, Representative Schultz moves the minutes from yesterday. That would be the 10th of January. Any discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Minutes are approved. All right. Today we have with us the Office of Higher Education. And I'm not sure how many I see Commissioner Folgemiller up there ready and a few others from his staff. So step forward and we will begin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members.
Welcome to the committee, Commissioner.
Great to be here. I'm Larry Folgemiller, Commissioner of Higher Education, and this is Nikki Oliver, who is the government affairs person for our agency and who mostly will interact with your staffs and you, obviously. If you,
Commissioner, would you like to pull that mic over to you?
Way over here.
That's good. Thank you.
So, Mr. Chairman, we tried to, we do have quite a few slides, but we'll try to get through them. And if people want to go into deeper detail than we're talking, please ask questions and we'll do the best we can.
All right.
So, first, just the general responsibilities of the Office of Higher Education. Administers the state financial aid program, state grant, work study, child care, American Indian scholarships, tuition reciprocity, and self-loans. We register degree granting institutions and license non-degree granting. And I think the way to think about that is licensing is a little heavier duty than registration. St. Thomas would register. A for-profit school would likely, not always, but likely license. We negotiate and administer tuition reciprocity agreements. We administer one or two federal grants. The biggest one is something called Get Ready that we'll talk about later. And we collect and maintain data on students in post-secondary institutions and have been given a research and reporting function on the effectiveness of post-secondary by the legislature. Funding of the agency. As all agencies, there's three general areas of money: general funds, other state funds, and federal funds, total of about $696 million. 68% of that is $471 million, and that is mostly money that goes out in need-based aid through either state grant, work study, child care, Indian scholarships, reciprocity. The second group, the $216 million, which is 31%, is mostly the self-loan program, which is state tax-exempt bonds that have no general funds that have been put forth, and then we put out lower interest student loans with the money coming out of that, and that's $209 million. And then there's some fee-based revenue through licensing and registration. It's about, and we spend about $1.2 million there in fee-based activity. There's also federal funds, basically two areas. About $6 million is in this Get Ready, which is a college preparation program that we run for the federal government. It's kind of a research-based program to figure out what works and what doesn't work, and we're one of maybe 10 states that have federal funds to do that. And then there's about $1.7 million in teacher training grants that we give to higher post-secondary institutions. We have 65 employees. In that first box, the general fund is about 22 employees that are funded out of there. Out of the other state funds, 23 employees, the people who run the self-loan program, are funded out of the self-loan program, not general funds. And then federal funds supports about 20 employees, so a total of 65. So the general fund supports 22 employees, and it's about, our administrative expenses are about 1.7% of our general fund money. We then have several things that are just pass-through money. The legislature makes an appropriation, and we basically are the fiscal agent for it. And that's Minitex and MinLink, which are basically library technology programs that are housed at the University of Minnesota, in essence, but they provide statewide access to library resources. And that's about $12 million. A small Midwest Higher Education Compact, which is a regional organization that we belong to. This is the dues for that. Medical training for physician residencies. And there's two areas. There's a direct appropriation to us that we give to the United Family Practice, which is basically St. Paul. And they fund some St. Paul and some rural residencies for medical. And then there's a $1.3 million biennial one for Hennepin County Medical Center, which is also for medical residencies. There's a small appropriation for some College Possible that many of you have probably heard about. It's a nonprofit that does college prep for students, low-income students. Then the Minnesota Minority Education Partnership gets an appropriation that we basically are the fiscal agent for. Overview then of kind of our activities. The legislature set an attainment goal for post-secondary attainment. That by 20, this was passed in the 15 session, I believe, 2015 session, so that there would be 70% attainment of either certificate, associate, or bachelor degree by the population between age 25 and 44 in Minnesota. And that this is legislatively set out, and that's 70% for by each race or ethnic group, in addition to the overall attainment rate. There's a bunch of details about interim benchmarks, et cetera. We did some work with the state demographer, and the estimate today is that Minnesota is at 60% relative to that 70%, and that 51.6% is at least an associate and above, and about 8.4%, which is what had to be estimated, are certificates. So if you add 51.6 and 8.4, you come up with about 60%. Key thing to note about this attainment, that mandate that was given by the legislature, is that we do not have very good rates relative to race and ethnicity. And that chart shows that. It's as low as 23% for our American Indian population between ages 25 and 44, and as high as 66% for the white and Asian population. Within the Asian populations, we always encourage people to separate, though. There's a difference between the Indian Asian and Hmong populations, for example, and Chinese. And, for example, the Hmong population would have a fairly low attainment rate, whereas the Indian population in Minnesota, Asian Indian population, has a fairly high attainment rate. And that has to do with a lot of that's immigrant populations and so forth. But so that's just a nuance. The general participation rates, part of this issue is that general participation rates in post-secondary also are impacted by race or free and reduced, et cetera. And that's all that chart demonstrates, that they're are higher college-going populations by race in Minnesota. Next slide, graduation rates by 2 year and 4 year is what this demonstrates. The dark blue are the 3 year transfer rates. In post-secondary, you can do graduation rates various ways. The most commonly accepted way is 3 year rates for 2 year programs, including transfers. And 6 year rates for 4 year programs is the common way. We can also give you data though on the 2 and the 4 year rates, but this is how it's commonly demonstrated. And you can see the differences by race and ethnicity. Then going into enrollment, debt, and financial aid, you can see the enrollment patterns for post-secondary in the state. And by and large, the story is that it's relatively flat except for two-year colleges, either proprietary two-year colleges or state colleges. And the reason those are not flat, their enrollment is counter-cyclical to the economy. Unemployment goes up, enrollment goes up in two-year programs. Unemployment goes down, enrollment goes down in two-year programs. Enrollment by race, the purpose of this graph is to show that, and the dark blue is four-year programs, the blue is four-year programs, the green is two-year programs. Dark is full-time and light is part-time. So what this chart basically says is that by race, there's a segmentation of the population both in two-year programs and part-timeness for students of color. So there tends to be, students of color tend to go more to two-year programs part-time than the white population. That's kind of the reason, that's what this chart kind of shows. Medium cumulative debt, and this is median, not average. And the key thing that we like to point out is that most of these really high debt levels that you hear is about graduate, is about professional programs. That's what that last set of charts is. So it's $139,000 median for your first professional degree. If you look at bachelor's degrees, you can see in 25, the median is now $26,800. That is down in the last few years. The average is a little higher, but the median, because it gets dragged up by people who have high debts. But the median is down for baccalaureates, $26,800. Minnesota is different than around the nation. We have lower default rates. We are a higher income state. We borrow more. We typically are fourth or fifth in the nation in borrowing for post-secondary education by families and students. But we're a higher income state, so there tends to be more borrowing when you're a higher income state. And the key element is that we're lower default. So whatever borrowing we're doing, we tend not to be getting into trouble where people are defaulting more compared nationally. That's not to say that people aren't borrowing too much. It's just to say that relative to others, our level of borrowing is not as risky as in other states. Financial aid. This chart just shows there's multiple kinds of financial aid, grants and loans, work study. And you can see that the overall amount of financial aid in Minnesota is about $3 billion in 2015. And it's gone up quite a bit from $1.5 billion in 2003. And that the bulk of the borrowing is by students, not by their parents. Another point, 58% of the financial aid, either borrowing or grant aid, need-based aid, comes from the federal government. So we're obviously heavy players in Minnesota with our state grant and with our self-loan program. But when all is said and done, still 58% comes from federal dollars, either Pell Grant or subsidized loans from the federal government. Appropriation trends. And I'm going to ask Thomas Stanford to just join me if I'm not explaining these charts correctly. These are just kind of big picture to give you a sense of I was listening a little bit yesterday, and there was some discussion of real dollars. And so what this chart shows is that in adjusted dollars, inflation-adjusted dollars, appropriations have declined as a percent of the state budget for post-secondary education. The general fund is the red line in the top one, and you can see the general fund has gone up quite significantly. Whoops, we need to push a button here.
Oh, sorry.
Ah, thank you. The red line, it shows the general fund, and you can see that relatively higher ed appropriations, that blue line in the upper graph, has stayed relatively flat in real dollars. The second chart below that makes the point that higher ed as a percent of the general fund has slipped from 14% to, I think the figure you used yesterday was 7.2. So we have 7 here, but I think the exact number is 7.2. And these are inflation-adjusted dollars here. Unemployment and appropriations. This goes back to the point that for particularly the two-year colleges, their enrollment is highly dependent on the state of the economy. And what this chart shows that when unemployment goes up, higher ed appropriations per student go down, and enrollment goes up. When unemployment goes down, higher ed appropriations go up, and enrollment goes down. Which seems to be working against each other. Did we move this? Yeah. People go to higher ed when they're unemployed, because they're looking to reskill. But the legislature doesn't have as much money when unemployment's up, and so you're kind of caught in a box there. So to some extent, those two counter-cyclical trends work against each other. And a key point is that when people talk about appropriations per student, that this fact is what mostly is affecting that, not the appropriations. The appropriations tend to keep moving nicely, maybe not as high as some would like, but the per student number is really dependent on the number of people that show up at the colleges.
Commissioner, we have a question. Representative Lean, you have a question?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chair. And Commissioner, do you have any information about, I know this is going back a couple slides, but default rates over the last 10, 15 years or so, or just as we've seen more people going to school, state appropriations coming down, if there's any information about tracking default rates?
In Minnesota, Mr. Chairman, our default rates in Minnesota have remained relatively flat even through all of that, even though the federal rates really, nationally, they really bounced. And again, that's relative to, we're a relatively high-income state, and people take on the debt they feel they can afford, apparently.
Another question, Representative Schultz. Representative Lean, do you have another question?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chair. Just to follow up clarification, so the national default rates have been going up. Okay, thank you.
I think they're coming down a little now, but they did spike. Clarification.
This is
Meredith Fergus, one of our fiscal analysts.
Welcome.
Thank you, Chair Norris, Representative Lean. I'm Meredith Fergus. I am the manager of financial aid research for the office. Actually, Minnesota rates did increase during the recession, but there was overall stability within default rates within the self-loan program. Wow. Those tend to have higher criteria for qualifying for a self-loan. Minnesota did see an uptick in its federal student loan default rates, as did all other states during the economic recession. We're seeing those start to come down a little bit, but our rates did not go up as high as other states.
For our program.
So they were more moderated.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I misstated that.
Representative Schultz, still have a question?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. So in slide 17, the top graph, you said those are adjusted for inflation, so those are in constant dollars?
That's correct.
What year constant dollars?
So we use 2015 through 16, well, we took 16 November, which was the last month of available data, and carried it forward for December 16 and into 17.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Representative Paley, you have a question?
Thank you, Chair and Commissioner. This might be more of a philosophical question, but I'm interested in your comments. When you look at low unemployment and then increased enrollment, I understand that juxtaposition. And what I'm hearing from employers is, in a very tight labor market, they may not want to wait for somebody to go to a two-year program, for an example, to get a skill training. They'll look for character traits, for example, and say, we'll train you on the job because we need you here today. So can you tell me a little bit about how, you know, higher ed institutions need to maybe innovate in these certificate programs or working with manufacturers in order to meet that trend? Because clearly our demographics would show us that the labor market's going to be tight. We aren't, so we may not get those students into a program because it's not needed from the employment community. So just interested in your comments.
Commissioner?
Mr. Chairman, I think that's exactly right. You have the dual things going on. I'm going to leave it to Minn State to explain all of their programming that they do. But they generally, through their customized training, attempt to respond directly to local employers related to that exact point. How well they're doing it, you hear both sides of that. And a lot of times what the economists say is that discussion sounds like a misalignment between post-secondary and employers, but it's really more of a market issue about how much you're willing to pay in that market. So I think it's not a clear picture. I don't think people can say definitively what exactly is going on, and it's in constant flux, and I think it would be best to have, I think it would be most informative to have Minn State explain on their campuses how they think that's going.
Okay. All right. Continue. And if there's a cell phone near a mic, they tell me that's the cause, and I don't know if it's really true, but that's all we got to go on, so try it.
Okay. Slide 19 then Mr. Chairman. Slide 19 then just reinforces the this unemployment issue, and it's mostly related to two-year enrollment. Slide 20, I guess it is. The point of this graph is total revenue per full-time equivalent is up, but a larger portion of that is tuition. So even though the overall trend line for revenue for our institutions is up, the bulk of that is coming out of tuition now as opposed to appropriations. And that whole chart is about relative to full-time equivalent students. Final chart in this general overview then is total revenue per student relative to U.S. averages. The dotted line is an index to the U.S. average. The blue line is appropriations per full-time equivalent. The orange line, I guess that is total revenue, full-time equivalent. And then the green line is net tuition, full-time equivalent. So that shows you relative to the federal government, or to federal averages, we're basically above average with regards to two of those. State grants. And Mr. Chairman, this is the area where we were struggling how much detail you wanted, so if we get into too much detail, just say for another time. Minnesota's largest program in post-secondary from the state is need-based aid.
Commissioner, could you just start by telling us that the fund is in pretty good financial condition?
Yes, very good financial condition, yes.
Yeah. All right.
The legislature has been very generous.
All right.
And with enrollment kind of either flattening or decreasing, that protects the fund. If enrollment's accelerating, then it's hard to kind of keep up.
There have been some occasions where that hasn't been the case, and we've had to refigure the formula, and some students have.
When the recession hit, I think Representative Pawlowski remember there was a terrible situation, 10-11, where, there was a problem. There was a lot of students and not as much financial aid. Not the case now.
Right.
A key thing to understand, we'll talk more about this later, but Minnesota's, and complement is spelled wrong there, it's C-L-E. Our need-based program is a complement to the federal program. It's not an addition. So the feds give $2 and then we give another $1 is not how our program works. It's all premised on the total cost of attendance, and we basically fill in after we figure out how much the student got in federal aid. So in that way, it's a complement to the federal Pell. It's designed that way. It's not just an add-on to the federal Pell. It's the state grant is for Minnesota residents attending Minnesota institutions. 86% of new students, undergraduates, fill out the FAFSA. That's that federal form. So a lot of people find out if they're eligible, 86%. You would assume that some people just kind of in that 10% go, no, my family income's $300,000. I'm not going to get any. But so we have a high, nationally, we have a high number of people that actually fill out the form, or families. One-third of resident undergraduates in Minnesota institutions get a grant, a state grant. And the numbers then are for 2016, there were 153,000 applicants, 82,000 became recipients.
Commissioner, you had indicated attending Minnesota institutions. That means all, right?
Yes.
Not just
the public, non-public, proprietary.
Yeah. Right. Okay. Okay. I can pause you for one more moment. Representative Albright has a question.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioner. The statement on your slide suggests Minnesotans attending Minnesota institutions. How would that be affected by reciprocal agreements with neighboring states?
We're going to talk about reciprocity in a second. This is separate from that.
Okay, thank you.
The next chart tries to give you by income range. It doesn't try. It does tell you by income range the number of recipients. And so you can tell it's obviously it's need-based, so it's weighed heavily to lower incomes. But the next chart shows you the mix of federal Pell money and state grant. And the blue is the state grant. So you can see as incomes go up, the state grant becomes more dominant. This is this issue of we're a complement to the federal money. We're not simply an addition to the federal money. The next chart shows that again. The orange is the Pell money at that income range, the average. The bar is the average you get, so less than 10,000, the average is about 5,720. The orange is the Pell amount, and the blue is the state grant amount. So you can see for some students, say at $80,000, they may not get much Pell. They would get 2,870 of state grant, though. The next is by sector. Obviously, if you give a grant to a student, that money shows up at some institution. And this chart explains where that money shows up. And you can see that 36% ends up at Minn State campuses, 27% at the University of Minnesota, 31% at non-publics, St. Thomas. And it's now down to 6% for the proprietaries of the for-profits. That used to hover around 10 or 11%, but with all the what's going on in the industry now, closing schools and stuff, it's now down to 6%. This chart just shows what the average state grant award has been, and you can see it's been on the rise modestly. And the way to think about that is purchasing power. You would want it to be going up because things get more expensive. Either tuition's gone up or your living expenses have gone up. So it's a good thing to have that rising.
Representative Schultz has a question.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just want to have a clarifying question. So you said the state grant is a complement but not a supplement, but you can qualify for both. So you're you're supplementing the Pell Grant with the state grant?
Yes.
It's an add-on. Supplemental.
It's an add-on, but it's not structured. Our state grant is a shared responsibility, what we're going to go into a second, which is different than Pell, which is totally based on what's your income, here's how much you get. Ours is based on this notion that the total cost of attendance is tuition fees plus living expenses, and we're trying to fill in for students in a way where they can handle both of those. So what's the net result of that? So a student at a two-year college can get more than, and if you're under $30,000, you are currently getting more than tuition and fees. You're getting tuition fees plus some living expenses. So that's the difference. We premise how we give out the state grant based on the combination of costs between living expenses and tuition fees.
So they can get both. Thank
yes.
you, Mr. Okay.
And thank they you. Do. Most okay. most get both.
Okay.
Just one more moment. Representative Bernardi has a question.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Commissioner Polga Miller, would this be appropriate time to just clarify how people qualify, you know, as far as their parents? This is what I understand, I may be wrong, but your FAFSA is based on your parent and the parent that is married to that parent, you know, versus your natural biological parent that lives in another household. It's like in your household, how much income is that? Is that the way it is? And then you're going to talk about that later?
Well, we'll get more in depth, but I think a general overview, this is a perfect time to have a general.
Okay, and then just one follow-up. And then I want to know, how does someone get become their own self-supporter? You know, what do they have to do to become now just relying on just their income to qualify? Independent student? Yeah, that's what I wanted to know.
Ms. Fergus?
Chair Nornes and Representative. Yes, the income that is used on the FAFSA typically is the income of the custodial parent, including their spouse, and that is governed by federal law. So we don't have a lot of control over that. In terms of how, depending upon the age of that parent, as well as whether both parents are working or only one is working, the federal government methodology varies in complexity about how much of income is assessed towards educational costs, as well as their assets. And that's about all I'm going to tell you, because it's like a 40-page document.
Representative Bernardi.
Okay, yeah, you can answer the other about independent student in a second, but the custodial parent, a lot of there is shared custody, mm-hmm. custody now. So when there's joint custody, how does that play into it?
Ms. Fergus?
Representative and Chair Nornes, I believe both parents' incomes are looked at, but it's typically the parent with whom the student spends 50% or more of time, if I'm remembering correctly. But I need to double check with our financial aid manager just to make sure I'm correct in that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
On the independent student, basically after, Mr. Chairman, Representative Bernardi, basically over age 24, except if there's very special circumstances, that there's some real stark evidence that the family's not involved in your life.
Okay, thank you.
Ms. Fergus?
Chair Nornes, I would add that it would also include students who are married, had a dependent child themselves, or were in military service.
Representative Bernardi?
Thank you. So the other question I have is then, is there a certain, you can do this for your four-year degree, your master's degree? We didn't get financial aid in our family, so I'm not really certain how it all works. So can they get it for a master's degree? Like my daughter who just finished a master's degree, could she get that, or is it for four-year degree? I mean, it's too late for her, but four-year degree?
Ms. Fergus?
Chair Norris, Representative. The state grant is only used for undergraduate degrees. However, and in terms of the dependency status, whether a student is dependent, meaning their parents' contributions are assessed versus their own, that if you graduate with a bachelor's degree, you automatically are given independent student status, so only your income applies in those situations. But the state grant is undergraduate only.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll follow up later.
Okay.
Thank you.
Commissioner.
Mr. Chairman, then slide 29 is just to point out the legislative direction when they created the state grant years ago. And there's two major points there. It's about both economic access based on income and choice. They choosing are in the best interest of the student. Do you want to do the design share? I think I'll maybe turn these details, and if it gets too deep, go like this and we'll stop. Ms. Fergus.
So far, you're just doing fine. I was going to add, if there was a theme for this committee, it probably would be access and choice for students. I think that's kind of what we're all looking for. So, Ms. Fergus?
I'm Chair Nornes. I, too, thought the commissioner was doing just fine. So in terms of the state grant, we operate under what is called the design for shared responsibility, meaning that educational costs should be split among three payers: students, families, and taxpayers, as you see on the slide. What this means is that in terms of the cost of attendance, we calculate the cost of attendance based upon the tuition fees that are, the average tuition fees that are charged to a student at an institution, so it is institution basis, up to a maximum, and currently that maximum is law set at the highest average tuition fees at a public institution.
So that would be the University of Minnesota for 4 years, and I believe it's Normandale for
correct.
2 years.
In addition, we allocate to the student a living and miscellaneous expense allowance that is currently set in law to the federal poverty threshold for a household size of one for 9 months of the year, which is currently $8,904. It says 20 on our slide. Yeah. These are what Commissioner Pogemiller just went over in terms of the actual maximum public tuition fees that we currently use. In addition, the allocation formula for the cost means that students pay the first 50%, families pay the remainder as their income and assets allow, and then taxpayers pay the difference, the assigned taxpayer responsibility. And I have a chart that shows through how those fit together in a little bit. In terms of how those numbers compare to current reality, what we see in the purple and blue bars on under living and miscellaneous expense allowance benchmarks is that the poverty level threshold is currently just below what the state grant living and miscellaneous expenses for this year. We had some budget, there was a little bit extra in this year's year two budget that we then distributed to students by increasing the LME. However, it is substantially lower than what college students on average spend during the year, which is the $12,727. Based on income expenditure data from the Bureau of Labor Statistics. The red and blue bars show the two average tuition fees by sector in the red bar, and then the blue bars represent what the maximum is within the state grant program. Any cost above the maximum is expected to be paid 100% by the student or their family. In terms of the student responsibility, we provided the statutory references for those. So students are assigned at least 50% of the cost of attendance, and this is based on the fact that they have a benefit received from education. The blue bars on this chart show what the average assigned student responsibility is for a full-time student by institution type. So for example, the average student at a Minnesota State College is expected to pay just over $7,500 per year out of their own income or savings towards the cost of attendance to cover both tuition fees and living expenses. Students at the University of Minnesota, that number grows to $11,753 because of the higher tuition amount. The green bars show how much a student could earn if they were earning $9.50 an hour and working half-time year-round, which is $9,500. And then the borrowing limits under federal student loans. It's $5,500 for undergraduates, so they can qualify for up to an additional $2,000 in certain circumstances. So students do have to kind of work carefully to make their finances meet their educational costs.
The key is the way this was designed by the legislature 30 years ago was shared responsibility. If you can pay, you should. But even if you're poor, there's some responsibility because it's not only 50% of it's a public benefit. The other 50% is a personal benefit, is the notion here.
Ms. Fergus.
The next payer is the family. And this is, again, the statutory reference. And it is based on an ability to pay principal. So as families have income and assets that they can contribute, they are expected to do so under the state grant formula. The third payer is the federal government in terms of the federal Pell Grant. Federal Pell Grants currently range from a minimum of $598 to a maximum of $5,815 this year. And now I have kind of a little set of charts that shows you how that builds. The first thing we do in calculating a student's state grant at various incomes is we calculate their price. So what you're seeing here is the combination of tuition and fees at the University of Minnesota plus living and expense allowance for this current year. Students automatically pay the first 50% regardless of income. Then the family share is assessed, and that is the result of the federal needs analysis that we modify in Minnesota law. And typically, for a dependent student, that starts at approximately $40,000 in income. They are expected to start contributing. Then the federal Pell Grant comes in. The Pell Grant is concentrated at those lower incomes and then tapers off starting at about the same $40,000 up to around $60,000, $65,000 in income. That is the group that's covered under Pell Grants. State grant fills in the remainder. So we then add to the student's Pell Grant the amount that needs to get them up to the additional 50% of cost. And you can see state grant extends beyond the Pell Grant range so that we allow a little more financial access for middle-income students in Minnesota.
And members, that's what we mean by a complement. It fills in, after you've done all this, it fills in the remaining amount.
Mm-hmm. Just one moment to Representative a question.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Yes, so when is the timing of this? When do students know they qualify for these loans?
Ms. Fergus.
Chair Nornes, Representative.
This is grants.
I mean grants.
Yes.
Sorry.
Actually, it just recently changed. Prior to the coming academic year, typically they could start filing their FAFSA on January 1st. However, as of this year, it moved to October 1st. So students, depending upon how fast colleges can get the information out and the student completes the form, they could actually know how much their federal Pell Grant is and what kind of institutional aid they would receive starting in November. So it's about 3 to 4 months earlier than in prior years. For the following September, correct.
Thank you.
State grants are a little bit different. We issue temporary parameters in November that tells colleges how to award a state grant, but of course we don't finalize those numbers until after session ends.
Ms. Fergus, if I can follow up on that. Assuming student as a junior, not quite ready for college yet, but looking ahead, is there a website or someplace where they can actually go and kind of pretend or at least get some idea, plug in some numbers to see about what they will need? Because I think that's something we miss. And when they get to college, it's a shock sometimes. So is that available?
Chair Nornes, yes. So actually, federal law requires that all colleges have a financial aid estimator or calculator on their website. So the student could go to the college that they're interested in and get information that way by plugging in the basics about their household size, intended program, and income and asset information. And it's just basic information. They can also do it on OHE's website.
Okay. Correct. I wasn't surprised, but I was thinking, we're not doing that, we need to, but it's good to hear they're doing that. So yeah. Representative Bernardi.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I have a question, and I know Commissioner Pogemiller has been around this Capitol for a long time, so he'll remember these policies from a while ago, and I think it's still in policy practice. Okay, so the long and short of it is, I just remember the state of Minnesota having this commitment to one-third, two-third. The student pays one-third, and the state
67%.
Right. That's still in policy, isn't it? And then the other question I have is, how does this all relate to that when you start to talk about 50-50? How does the, explain that policy and if it still exists and if the language has changed and how this all relates to that? And has the state actually really changed their practice, their policy? Please explain that to me.
Commissioner Pogemiller.
Well, there's a long explanation, Ms. Chairman, Representative Bernardi, there's a long explanation of the history of that. But basically what the policy and the statute now is that the expectation is that 60% of the student's instructional costs will be covered by the taxpayer. It's been years since people have been dealing in the instructional cost kind of calculation. So to figure out what the actual number is today relative to it, we would have to ask the university and Minn State to do the calculation based on what they say the instructional cost is. We think, I think a fair guess is it's less than 50% right now.
That's what I'm hearing.
And I had a number somewhere, if you took just appropriation, maybe that just confuses us, but.
No, go ahead.
Thomas, what are the two numbers you ran for? This is now not the exact calculation because it's not instructional cost.
Mm-hmm.
So, Mr. Chair, Representative, sorry. So the language changed over time. Initially, it was all based on instructional costs. And because we no longer collect that information from the institutions, it switched to a tuition plus appropriations figure calculation. And so the specific language of the statute says 67% of the combined revenue of tuition and appropriations and the university fee from the University of Minnesota, which has been discontinued, which is no longer active. And where we are depends on the sector, but we are certainly below 50% across the board, and in some places closer to 33%, I believe.
Bernardi, is that satisfactory?
The University of Minnesota. Mr. Chairman, the University of Minnesota is probably closer to 33%.
Okay, and then Mr. Chair, so that word is,
Bernardi.
You know, the expectation, I think the word actually might be intent. Is that in state in our constitution? No, it's, where is it at?
It's a statute.
It's a statute, okay.
We can dig out the reference here, but someone
thank
might
you.
Have it.
That's okay.
All right.
Thank you.
43. Ms. Burgess, you can continue, I guess.
Yep. Thank you, Chair Nunes. While these other charts are very nice and they help explain how we calculate a state grant, this is not what the student sees when they receive their financial aid. They tend to see things in reverse. So typically when they are notified of their financial aid available, they are notified of the cost of attendance, of course, that the college calculates for them. And then they are notified of how much they receive in Pell Grants and how much they receive in state grants. And then they are asked to figure out how to cover the remaining amount, which is shown in light blue. That is the amount to be paid by the student or family through income, through savings, or through student loans. And this is what it would be for a student at the University of Minnesota Twin Cities being full-time dependent, and of course at Normandale Community College. We provided a couple of examples.
Okay, then Mr. Chairman, just moving on to other financial aid programs, which we won't go into as much detail. But there's a, and we've just kind of listed them here, there's American Indian Scholarship, which is an additional scholarship on top of all of these other aids. There's the Minnesota GI Bill, which is on top of federal GI Bill. There's some small grants to a couple tribal colleges because they educate some non-tribal members, and so the legislature has given a small appropriation for the for those students. I'll pass over the justice, some public defenders. There's a federal program called the John R. Justice Program that helps repay loans for public defenders. We have 23 people in Minnesota still getting those. There was a program that this committee and the Senate committee created a couple years ago, the Minn State Two-Year Occupational Grant Pilot Program, about 819. This was that last dollar in at a community college for a student who wanted to go to a community college. There's a teacher shortage loan repayment program. There's about 10,000 students on state work-study dollars. There's also federal work-study money. There's a separate post-secondary child care grant that is distributed by institutions for students who have child care needs. That's on top of the county child care grants that people would think of. And there's a lot more money, obviously, in the county system than here. There's a small public safety officer survivor grant program. If you're a dependent child of an officer who was killed in the line of duty, and there are apparently six of those in Minnesota now, there is some money available for those students. There was this dual training grant program that was created by these committees a session or two ago that provides employers assistance to train on the question that was raised earlier, specifically for the types of things they need, and to create some kind of training program with the college over that. That's what those dollars are for. And then there's a small tax credit program, the Greater Minnesota Internship Tax Credit.
Commissioner? We have a question from a member, Representative Omar. Your first question of the session.
Thank you, Chair.
You have many more available.
A lot of the questions I have, other members are asking, so it's been helpful. Commissioner, I just wanted to get a clarification for the post-secondary child care grant. Is that a state or federally administered grant?
Commissioner?
Mr. Chairman, Representative Omar, it's a state appropriation that is given to colleges that they can then give students.
Okay. Representative Schultz.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Commissioner, the occupational grant pilot program, I think $5 million was allocated for the first year of that pilot. Does that mean that if we're only spending $1.5 million, we're not exhausting the $5 million, and does that roll over to the next year of the program?
I'm going to defer.
Ms. Fergus?
Chair Nardis, Representative, have no fear. We will easily spend $5 million this year. We currently spend just over $1.5 million in grants for fall term. We still have to pay out spring and summer, so we still have 60% of the year left. In addition, there was an additional $1.3 million, $775,000 to pay for mentoring. That also comes in there.
Thank you.
All right.
Mr. Chairman, then reciprocity. We have, there are 42,000 participants, 28,000 Minnesotans, and 14,000 non-Minnesotans who come here, 28 that go to other states, and 14 that come to our state. There are 5 agreements with North Dakota, South Dakota, Manitoba, Wisconsin, and 1 community college in Iowa. Only 2 of those agreements have state payments involved. So they would be agreements, without state payments. It basically says, we'll take your student at our price. Mm-hmm. And that's usually lower than the price they would have had in our state. But for the 2 major states, and this chart shows how many students are going which way. So for example, North Dakota, 11,000 Minnesotans are going to North Dakota institutions, 4,400 North Dakotans are coming to Minnesota institutions. The other major players, Wisconsin, 14,000 Minnesotans go to Wisconsin institutions, 8,400 come this direction. People often ask, if we help someone go to a different state to go to college, do we lose them? And the statistics are this. For students who came here under reciprocity, 47% stay here. So if you came from Wisconsin and come to a Minnesota institution, 47% of those students end up on our job roles after 3 years.
Commissioner, if I can stop you for just a moment. Representative Schultz.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So Governor Walker in Wisconsin is talking about lowering the tuition, not just freezing tuition at the UW system. So do you have the price elasticity, and can you figure out what that potential impact will be in the near future?
Commissioner.
Mr. Chairman, we can talk about that right now. We don't know exactly what it is, but there's some trend lines here. And I was going to point to the next chart that shows for the two that we have transfer payments, North Dakota, can you hit the button? North Dakota and Wisconsin, we pay North Dakota annually about $6.9 million for the students that we send over there. And Wisconsin pays us roughly $5.1 million. And this has to do with the formula that is used relative to what it costs either you, Madison, to educate our student or not. And they're fairly complex, and I'm going to ask Mr. Stanford to briefly describe what those two formulas do, North Dakota and Wisconsin, and how they kind of roughly work.
Mr. Stanford.
Thank you, Chair. Briefly, the North Dakota payment is based on the number of the gap in FTEs of the number of students from Minnesota going to North Dakota versus the number of students from North Dakota coming here. And then it takes into account their total revenue, their educational revenue, and it uses a marginal instructional cost formula. So the idea is that these institutions have costs regardless of having that additional student enrolled in the class. And so we are not charged for the full instructional cost for each student that goes. We're charged 64% of that number. And then they also, our students in North Dakota pay a 12% premium above their resident rate. And so that 12% premium is also deducted from the total that we pay North Dakota. On the Wisconsin side, it's interesting, we actually both overpay in terms of the instructional cost it costs to educate the students. So it's the greater of the overpayments sends a check the other way. So we're both covering, both sets of students are covering their instructional costs, but because there's more money left over on their bottom line, they send us a check for the students that come here.
Mr. Chairman, general trend line. The number of us paying North Dakota is going up. The number of Wisconsin paying us is going down. So today, it nets out, it cost us, reciprocity, cost Minnesota about $1.8 million, I think that says. But that number is starting to get bigger, the net number. And so we are in discussion with Governor Dayton recently. We are going to be in the process of discussing our situation with North Dakota to reduce our state payment to them. From a student perspective, why would I go to North Dakota? I live in a suburb in the Twin Cities, but I want to go to North Dakota. I don't know what the exact figure right now is, but a few years ago, for basically 60% of the price, you could go to North Dakota and get an engineering degree as opposed to the University of Minnesota. That's why a student might choose to do that. On the issue of the Madison one, we're all very familiar with. Some students just want to go to Madison rather than the U of M. On this issue of elasticity, I want to be careful how I say this because we're talking with North Dakota, but we think that difference is so great that North Dakota doesn't need as much money from us right now, and they still want the students, so that we think that they will take a change in that arrangement. But for a Minnesota student going to North Dakota, their tuition will go up. But it still won't be as high as the University of Minnesota, as an example. Mm-hmm. So you got all of those things going on at once, and I wish we could give a simple answer to the elasticity question, but you know, because there's a population issue here. There clearly are more Minnesotans going to North Dakota because we just have more people. And we save, in a big picture, we save money if we don't have to pay for institutional capacity at some of our institutions mm-hmm. to cover all those students. Now that argument weakens when you have declining enrollment at some of your institutions. But it's a good argument when you have more students than you can handle. So it depends on the timing of all this and what what the cost benefit is for the family.
Commissioner, we have a question here from Representative Haley.
You mentioned that 47% of the students that come here on reciprocity stay here. Do you know of our students who are leaving to get educated elsewhere? Do they come back? Do you have those statistics?
I think I might have slightly
mistaken.
The expert's going to stay what that number actually is.
Sorry. Thank you, Chairman and Representative. Just to clarify, yeah, the commissioner earlier, the 47% is of the students who come to the University of Minnesota. 47% of those students stay. The students who come to a Minsky institution, I believe the number is 35% stay. Of the students, of Minnesota residents who leave out of state, 60% return within 3 years, show wages within 3 years in the state.
Thank you, Chair.
Commissioner, when I was looking at this last slide with the states indicating where the students are going or coming from, it looked like we had a real problem here in the state, but when you mention the population difference, it does make a little sense. So it's maybe less of a problem than it appeared. Mr. Sanford?
Sorry. Clarify one other point, Mr. Chair. Thank you. Most of the 75% of the students who participate attend an institution within 50 miles of their home. So it is very regionally based, the program. And the population, as you mentioned, the size of North Dakota is over seven times the size of their population and their high school population. So
I think Mr. Chairman,
won't mention the bison. So
Mr. Chairman, I don't remember the exact number, but I think one of their major institutions has about 40-45% of their students are from Minnesota. So their viability as an institution is dependent on our students going there.
Couple questions. I'm going to start with Representative Daniels, since this is the first question of the day.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Commissioner Folgermeyer, I'm originally from up in the Bagley, north, west part of the state. And typically when people in that area are thinking about going to college, there isn't a lot of big colleges within about a four-hour drive. University of Minnesota being, about 4.5-hour drive. So a lot of them end up going to, like NDSU, it's much closer. Cost-wise, like you mentioned, it's much better. But do we have any data of where the majority of the students from Minnesota, when they go to North Dakota, what part of the region of Minnesota they're coming from? Is it kind of a region or just all over the state?
Mr. Sanford?
So, Chair, Representative, we currently have not looked at data of where they're coming from. We know where they're attending, and 90-something percent of them that are going to North Dakota are going to NDSU or UAD, which are both right on the.
Yep.
Yeah. But we do know that 75% of all participants are going to an institution, over 75, are going to an institution within 50 miles of their home.
Thank you. So that would Chair, one more question.
Representative Daniels.
Would we be able to get some of that data? Would that be possible to find just a kind of a general statement of where these students are coming from in Minnesota going to North Dakota?
Mr. Chairman, Sanford.
Representative, we are actually working on that. We're trying to establish a data sharing agreement with both North Dakota and Wisconsin to, as well as DEA, to get the wage information that we need to do further analysis. But we currently do not have the data for Wisconsin, so we're working towards that.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Chair.
Representative Bernardi, do you still have a question?
Yes, I do. Thank you, Mr. Chair. So I was wondering if Mr. Sanford, is that correct? Is that
the Chairman and Representative Sanford?
Sanford. Okay, thank you. Could you give us that data, what you said about who comes, goes out, the percentage, and who comes back?
Sure.
Because I couldn't get it all written down. And then this is a question, Mr. Chair, for Representative Folgermiller.
Okay.
Commissioner, should have been.
I was a
commissioner. Yeah. Oh, you were. Okay.
There's more. There's part two here.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I think the figure is 60% of Minnesota residents who left and went to Wisconsin, North Dakota, or South Dakota had earnings in Minnesota within 3 years.
Yeah. Well, you. Okay.
And 47% who came here to the University of Minnesota stayed after 3 years, and 35% who came to a Minn State campus stayed.
Okay, Mr. Chair.
Oh, Representative Bernardi.
Thank you. My request was just to get us that in a slide or something, written up. Could you get that to us in another document?
Sure.
Okay, thank you. And then my question for Commissioner Folgermiller is, Have we ever been in reciprocity with any other states?
Commissioner?
Mr. Chairman, I heard somebody ask that yesterday. I think it was you. Nebraska, right?
Yeah, that's what I was guessing.
We, through MEC, the Midwest Higher Educational Consortium, we belong to a Midwest student exchange with states like Nebraska and Colorado. So these are not reciprocity states. They're an exchange state. And so with Nebraska, for example, we have an arrangement where they will, you can pay, is it Minnesota? You pay 150% of resident tuition if a Minnesotan goes to Nebraska, for example. So those are not reciprocity agreements. Those are exchange through this Midwest compact.
Okay, thank you.
All right. Representative Lean.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just a comment in your conversations with the governor about how we can come up with a better balance as far as the financial implications of this. Just a thought I have is with some of the workforce issues and some of the natural demographics of Minnesota, I think it would really behoove us to think about how we can be getting more of those students over here. Like I say, not just to balance the money, but just getting more people in the state, I think would really improve not just the state, but also some of the workforce issues. So thank you.
Commissioner?
Then, Mr. Chairman, members, slides 50 is this self-loan program. This is the Minnesota program for student debt. And I think the slide, this slide is right. What's in your handout, it was kind of mucked up a little bit. But the bottom line, oh, and this is Danette Jerry, who helps manage this program. This is for Minnesota residents attending a Minnesota institution or some out-of-state institutions. Or it's a non-resident attending a participating Minnesota institution. And these are loans now. And one of the key things here is you have to have a co-signer for these loans. So, and that brings some security to the whole issue. It's usually a parent, mostly a parent.
Commissioner, this is not in our packet?
It is there. It's just that it's back one maybe here. Yeah, it's in your packet. It's just okay. Typed a little funny.
It looked different. So. Okay.
Again, we rearranged it a little bit.
We rearranged it. What's here is the, anyway.
Okay.
Just there's a modest typing issue in the packet.
Okay, go ahead.
So the loan volume in 2016 was $66.7 million and 8,500 loans. The loans outstanding for all loans over all the years of the program is $540 million, 64,000 borrowers. Repayment terms are or 10 or 15 or 20 years. They're variable and fixed rates. And the annual loan limits are those that are listed there. And we have very low default rates for this. So this, the way to think about this is, since we're using tax-exempt bonds to finance this, we can have lower interest rates probably than private lenders, but in many cases, certainly better than parent plus loans at the federal level, but not always better than all federally subsidized loans. So it's not always better than federal loans. The way people think about it in the industry is pretty much take your highly subsidized student federal loans first, then take your state loan, and then take a parent plus loan, and lastly, take it from a private vendor, private bank or something. 2 years, or in 2015, the legislature asked us to create a refinancing program, and we started that in 2016. It's for Minnesota residents who have graduated with a credential. And we have 5, 10, or 15-year repayment plans, variable fixed, and the maximum loan amount, now you can consolidate loans. You can consolidate private loans, federal loans, a previous self loan, and you can consolidate up to $70,000 or for a 4 year or 25 for 2 year. And today, after 1 year, we have about $26 million in refinancing with about 830 borrowers. We are in the process of studying what we learned in that first round so that we can maybe expand the pool of people who could refinance. Today, for example, you need to have what kind of FICO do you have to have?
Oh, you need a 712.
Say who you are first.
Oh,
Jerry.
Yes. Chairman Ornas and representatives, I'm Danette Jerry. Right now, you need to have a 720 FICO score without a cosigner or a 650 with a cosigner who has a FICO score of 720 or above.
And that's pretty solid. So we would like to expand yes. that to lower FICOs. But the key point is there's no subsidy here from the state. This is if they default on these refis, that falls back on the other borrowers of self-loan. So these are not subsidized by general appropriations. We would love if you did that, but you haven't decided to yet.
Representative Schultz.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just have a question on loan terms. Do we have any state statutes that set the interest rate or pegs it to an interest rate? So,
Chairman Nornes, representative, no, there is no statute currently in place for the interest rate. We borrow money with bonds, and so we have to be able to recover our costs. And that's really what determines our interest rate, are the costs of the loans.
Could you give an example of where it's at right this moment?
Right now, our chairman, representatives, right now our refinancing loans variable rate varies from 3.3% to 4.65%, and it goes up as your repayment term goes up. You make that choice. The fixed rate loan is 4.25, and it can go up to 6.75%.
Schultz.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So do we have any statutes that regulate the private financial industry on interest rate loan terms? Do you know?
Jerry.
Chairman Nornes, representative. Right now, I think there's just like a usury interest rate, so it's very high.
Okay, thank you.
Representative Pryor.
That was my question.
Okay. You're either batting 100% or losing. I'm not sure which way it's going.
Questions
here.
Get answered
yeah.
somehow.
Well, they're good questions. So, Representative Bernard, did you have something to add?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just want it for the record that we're not making any profit from these loans, because I believe I understand the federal government actually makes money off of student loans. Is that accurate?
Chairman Nornes, representative, we do make a slight profit. It stays within the fund so we can lower interest rates later. Because we borrow money with bonds, investors don't want to invest in a program that's losing money. So you try to make just enough to keep investors happy and the borrowers not paying too much.
All right, thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I think the key point is stays within the program mm-hmm. to cover defaults.
Right.
So it's not profit in the sense that the money shows up in the general fund.
Mm-hmm. Representative Lean.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And Ms. Jerry or Commissioner, do you have any idea of either how much of the outstanding loans or dollar amount or the number of the actual loans are going to people who go to school in the state versus out of state? And is there something to that against the issue with the reciprocity and we getting less money than we're putting out?
Ms. Jerry?
Chairman Nornes, representative, are you talking about just the refinancing? Because that is only tied to Minnesota residents and not where he went to school.
Mr. Chair, I guess I was looking at the self-loan program itself. It says Minnesota residents attending a participating Minnesota or out-of-state school.
Well, Mr. Chairman, Commissioner? We will find what we can on that and forward it to you.
Sure. Okay. Thank you.
It's related to out-of-state school. Okay. Then, Mr. Chairman, institutional licensing and registration. I'm going to ask Betsy Talbot, who some of your offices have dealt with. She's our director of licensing and registration. And this is the group that provides consumer protection and also deals with licensing and registration of, by and large, proprietary institutions. So with some of them going out of business recently, this is who they're dealing with. Just a short brief, and I think I'll try to do this, and Betsy can help me. The way it's called an accountability triad in this nation on post-secondary licensing and registration, and the triad is the federal government through the U.S. Department. It's the states, offices like ours, and then the third is accreditors who are non-government people. They are higher ed people. They've created their own associations, basically, and they do accrediting for higher ed institutions. So that would be like a lawyer's board governing lawyers. This is what goes on with accrediting. And so you have those three pieces. In addition, you have licensing boards, board of teaching, board of nursing, police officers boards, posts, that have requirements for what you need to have in your curriculum to be able to take the tests and things. The next slide kind of points out that there's 36 non-government accrediting agencies. This is the Higher Learning Commission as example, and there's out one west. I forget what that one's called. There's one in various parts of the state. And counterintuitively, quality of accrediting is usually viewed as better if you're regionally accredited as opposed to nationally accredited. You would think of national accreditor, that's good. It's kind of the opposite in post-secondary education. So the University of Minnesota, Minn State, St. Thomas, they all go to a regional accreditor, the HLC. Rasmussen, a proprietary, also does a regional accreditor, but that is unusual that they've done that. Typically, the proprietaries use national accreditors, ASICs and others. And those are the ones that people, that there's a lot of controversy about these national ones now.
Commissioner, just a quick question. What would be the makeup of the non-government accrediting agency? Who would that be?
Okay, Mr. Chairman, members, college presidents sit on them often. I think the HLC, the president of St. Olaf, sits on that right now. The national one, the president of Globe, sat on their national accrediting agency. So it's typically higher ed types that are on it, and college presidents are an example.
Specific number of individuals, I assume, how big it would be, but.
I don't, we would have to do some checking.
We maybe don't need to know today.
Various sizes.
Yeah, okay, just.
So specific in our office then, we do some curriculum approval, we monitor financial viability, monitor advertising and recruitment practices. Schools pay fees to our agency, it's a little under $1 million right now, for that. So I don't know what the exact, could you give an example of how much fees somebody would pay our office for this purpose?
Chairman Nornes and representatives, a renewal fee for an institution that's already regulated by our office is $1,200 per institution. That's paid annually. And then there's also fees to add academic programs. For a new school, fees range from $250, and I think the largest that I've seen since I've been here was actually an out-of-state institution wanting to offer online programs, and that was approximately $19,000, and that was Boston University, because they had a very large portfolio of academic programs to offer in our state.
Representative Bernardi, you have
a question here? Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm interested in getting a list. Is this possible, a list of our higher institutions and which ones are accredited and where they got their accreditation? And the reason why I'm asking if you can do this, I'd be interested in all that by institution, but can you also just talk a little bit about programs? Because I remember when St. Thomas first started their law school, they weren't accredited at first, and then eventually they got accreditation. So can you just say a little bit about the difference of programs versus the actual institution themselves?
Sure.
Ms. Talbert.
Thank you, Chairman Nornes and representatives. So there are different types of accreditation, which is why we had listed 36. An institution can have an institutional accreditor, mm-hmm. and that would be like the Higher Learning Commission, mm-hmm. where they accredit the institution as a whole and all of their academic programs underneath them. Mm-hmm. And then you can also have accreditors that specialize in accreditation of specific programs. So you have accreditors that specialized in law, which is the American Bar Association. So when St. Thomas offered their law degree, they had to seek initial approval from our office, and they also had to get approval from the HLC, which is the Higher Learning Commission. And after they established that program and they met the requirements from the American Bar Association, they could seek approval and accreditation through the ABA. And then once those students had gotten, or the school had gotten, the ABA accreditation, then those students would be eligible to sit for the bar exam. So typically, there are licensing requirements that are tied to institutional accreditation, or they could also be tied to that specific program type accreditation.
Oh, okay. Can anything start before that final accreditation? Could they start offering courses with an assumption, or can't they do that?
Chairman Norman, yes, actually, you can start a brand-new institution in the state of Minnesota. We give them a five-year window to establish accreditation. So they won't be eligible for federal financial aid during that time. And so because they don't have federal financial aid, they also are not eligible for state financial aid. But we do provide new institutions the opportunity to start up in the state of Minnesota and establish that accreditation.
All right, Commissioner.
Mr. Chairman, then I think just wrapping up, well, hopefully on some other programs here. How do you do that?
For another program, so.
This thing, okay. Nikki, do you want to come back and help me? So we have just very small programs. There's an intervention for college attendance program called ICAP, where there's about a $1.3 million appropriation, competitive grants to post-secondary institutions, to enhance attendance and graduation by underrepresented students, either first generation or students of color. About 3,600 students in 16 were affected, and about 4,315. There's a summer academic enrichment program, that $200,000 biennium, and this creates stipends, usually about $1,000, for students grades 3 through 12 to participate in enrichment programs in the summer. A science program, math something or other.
This is like
Nursing, scrubs programs is one many people have heard.
I have the list.
Yeah, we can provide you a list of that, but it's basically enrichment things that many families send their children to. This provides a scholarship for families who can't afford it, basically. There are actually 51 programs at 18 sites that are eligible for those scholarships. Student and parent information activities, about $244,000. We do a lot of publications about dual credit, about other APIB, about other things to help students prior to, you know, while they're still in junior high and high school, to kind of get themselves prepared for post-secondary institution. And we've impacted about 6,300 students. Yeah, this is all just this year. These numbers are what happened this past year. We have started something called a summer nudging program, which is basically text messages to students who sign up saying, the deadline for FAFSA is September 12th. Have you done that yet? Have you talked to your high school counselor? Did you take the courses that you said you were going to take? So it's basically text messages to students to keep them on track, because it's typically for students who don't have a brother or sister who went to college, or a parent who went to college, and they're just not sure what all these things are. And we've been it's a volunteer, but we're trying to create partnerships with the offices at St. Cloud State and the University of Minnesota to cover most of their freshmen, actually. So it's kind of expanding, and we're doing it, which there's literally one of our staff people who sends out these text messages. So it's really not very costly. And the reason for that is one in five college-bound students, someone who says, I am going to college, I'm filling out FAFSAs, they never make it. And so this is to say, let's catch those one out of five and say, you're on the path. Hang in there and get there. Then this federal program, Get Ready, Gear Up. We have a $6 million grant from the federal government that we've had for, seems like about 7 or 8 years. It's a research-based grant. We're part of a consortium that's doing research, so we do accountability and research around this, where we're in 9 sites, elementary, middle, and high schools in Minnesota, basically Brooklyn Center, Minneapolis, and St. Paul buildings, individual buildings. And we serve about, this group serves about 4,000 students, and it's basically doing all kinds of counseling and college prep-type activities with at-risk students who need help on how to get to college. First generation kids of color, low income kids.
Commissioner, we have a question. Representative Haley.
Thank you, Chairman. And Commissioner, is this the U of M's ramp up to readiness program, or is this a different program?
Commissioner.
Mr. Chairman, Representative, it is different, but they are similar in style and concept.
Okay.
And the research being done with regards to this federally funded stuff is to check out some of the things like Ramp Up the Readiness is doing and verify or not verify whether those things work.
Okay, thank you.
But Ramp Up the Readiness is fabulous what they do.
My district is, and I was part of implementing that. I know we were a pilot district, so that's why I wondered if it was the same.
Commissioner Hall.
Chairman, I'm sorry.
Well, go ahead.
I have another question.
Representative Haley.
Thank you, Chairman and Commissioner. This is unrelated to the previous question, but a more global question. We've talked a lot today about grants and loans, and I'm curious to kind of get your opinion on the other subject of cost. Certainly, we all know college costs have been escalating and escalating. And as we look at our goal for 70% attainment rate, I think we have to address cost. So I don't want to know about cost of living. I know apartment expenses are going up, et cetera. But do you have data either today or another time on the root causes and the trends of college costs? And can you break it down by where is that cost escalation coming from within the institutions? I would love to see that data.
Commissioner.
Mr. Chairman, Representative, that's a big topic.
Mm-hmm.
And why don't we put something together and provide it to you? And
right.
With one caution. Forewarning, I guess. We do develop data around this. The institutions don't always agree with it.
Understand.
And so there will be some tension there.
Mm-hmm.
But there are books written about this.
Right. Well, it's a reality that we have to face, just like in healthcare and other things. We have to look at the cost equation side and understand it in order to come up with solutions.
Chairman, we'll put something together and forward it to you and then continue the discussion.
Right. Representative Bernardi?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chair. I was just wondering on this get ready, gear up, how those three school districts were selected?
Mr. Chairman, Representative Bernardi, I think kind of a combination of volunteer and cohort of students. So this has been a few years, so I can't say specifically, but they had to agree and want to do this because they have to put their own resources in terms of counselors and so forth.
Okay, and Mr. Chair, just to follow up, the reason why I asked is that those three school districts tend to be in like the top four highest school district with poverty, and I thought maybe that's why they were picked. I know another school district that I happen to represent is usually now in the top three, so I was wondering if that was a possibility, actually.
And, Commissioner?
And, Mr. Chairman, this is not every building in these districts.
Okay.
These are separate buildings in these districts that have volunteered. But Brooklyn Center has been a very active participant.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, they have to be Title I schools in the first instance. The federal requirement is that.
Okay.
So it would tend to show up in those schools.
All right, I see no other
questions. Then, Mr. Chairman.
Can you hold up for just a second?
Oh.
I have a question here from Representative Omar.
Thank you, Chair. Commissioner, I'm interested in knowing a little bit more about the Summer Academic Enrichment Program. It says here that there's 252 students on the waiting list. What is some relief that we can provide in order for students who are on the waiting list to get off? How can we expand that program? Because if 700 students are currently participating, it looks like it is something students are interested in.
Commissioner?
Mr. Chairman, Representative, a larger appropriation would provide more scholarships.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of that straightforward. We would be all for that.
All right, back to you, Commissioner.
And Mr. Chairman, Representative, we will get you some more specifics on where those programs are, who's participating. We'll get you some detail on that. Ms. Oliver will bring some. Do we have a handout today? I guess we have a handout today, too. Then, Mr. Chairman, on slide 60. I don't know if I got there. I think slide 60, which one are we on? The legislature funded in the non-budget year. Remember, there was a big discussion about equity last session. And we had a fairly significant, the governor had a fairly significant ask of, seems to me it was $30 or $40 million. Well, we got $500,000. And that's what this grant was. And we have given out equity and education job connection grants. Three grants were given out, St. Paul College, Riverland College, and Mankato. And they're basically meant to provide some funds for those campuses to do best practices activities around advising, mentoring, to help students who are in their buildings finish, retain, and complete. And we think the institutions could certainly use some help on this. This is about counselors, about program design, restructuring of developmental education, et cetera. some little odds and ends. The legislature gave us a appropriation for $1 million for spinal cord and traumatic brain injury research grants. And so we've put out some grants for researchers. I think it's 2 or 4 grants now for researchers that do research in traumatic brain injury. We have concurrent enrollment course grants, $680,000 for the biennium, and that money was meant to create additional concurrent enrollment opportunities, not to pay for the current ones, but to create new ones. There was an appropriation for $300,000 for student debt counseling. That money was given to the Lutheran Brotherhood, Lutheran Social Services, who is already in the debt counseling business, and this was to expand their activity. And we're waiting for some, we're going to do a report on did that money help or didn't it help. And then finally, our last function in our office is research. And we have about 30 mandated reports every year by the legislature. And those are around things like tuition reciprocity, state grants, higher ed attainment, et cetera, sexual assault. The next page, we're mandated to create a sexual assault website, and that's what this is an example of. That went live January 1st, roughly, or December 15th. So there is now a site mandated by the legislature where institutions report to us their instances of reported sexual assault and adjudication of that. Again, mandated by the legislature. So that's an example. And then lastly, there's something called a SLEDS, Statewide Longitudinal Educational Data System, set up by the legislature and the Fed, and the, with the feds did some seed funding about seven years ago. There was some federal money and the legislature adopted this, where you basically have multiple agencies combine their data sources, human services, DEED, OE, health, eventually, and that's not all there now, but eventually combine your data sources so that you can figure out what's going on with government spending related to individuals. And there's all kinds of privacy requirements and stuff here, but basically the idea was to expand reporting on educational outcomes and to evaluate effectiveness of programs. So workforce and education basically are the two major players. This is governed through the P20 partnership. Those of you who have been around, that's something that's kind of known to the K-12 crowd or the K-12 committees. And it's a partnership between higher ed, K-12, and workforce. And there's players from all of those sitting on those. Usually it's the chairs of these committees, plus our office and DEED and Brenda Casilia, the department people, and we, University of Minnesota is on it. And that group kind of governs all of this. And it's being built as we sit here. And the last slide shows some of the things where you can see some of the results if you go online. And we provide both public information through these websites, but we also provide information back to partners. For example, we provide, if you're Columbia Heights High School, we provide information back to you from higher education that tells you what happened to your graduates. Did they go to St. Thomas? Did they go to the U of M? Did they not go? And so this provides information back to those schools on their own students, and it also provides information to the colleges about the students that they have. Where did they come from? What happened to them in high school, et cetera. So it's a sharing between institutions and researchers across government bureaucracies. So, I suppose I'll get people going, but this is big data. And there's a lot of protections in here in terms of privacy and so forth. But this is big data analytics to try to figure out what's going on with government programs and what's going on so that you can do some evaluation. And we'd love to come back and talk to the committee about what's possible there and what's happened there. One simple example, and then I'll wrap up. It used to be people said, Oh my gosh, 43% to 50% of high school graduates take remedial courses when they get to college. That was kind of what people said. With SLEDS, we were actually able to figure out what's the reality there. And the reality is 25% to 26% of Minnesota high school graduates end up in remedial, but they are basically at two-year institutions where it's about 43% or 45% who show up at two-year institutions that end up in remedial. If you go to the University of Minnesota or St. Thomas, the odds are not very strong that you'll do remedial. So we were able to figure out the information in a way that was now hopefully more useful to policymakers.
Commissioner, we have Representative Breyer with a question. Go ahead.
Thank you, Chairman. Mike, how long has this been going on?
Mr. Chairman, Representative, the initial federal funding was, I think I was just told, 7 years ago.
Okay.
So it's been a system that's slowly being developed over the last 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
In the original incarnation, the money was provided through K-12, but the decision was made in Minnesota, I believe 3 years ago, to have it reside in higher ed, mm-hmm. in our office, partly because we have relationships on data with private colleges that they don't have to give us. And so there just seems a more free flow there. And there is now federal funding to, I call it baby SLEDS, where they're developing early childhood data around what's going on in early childhood that will ultimately plug into this larger SLEDS database. And today it's pretty much limited to deed or employment data, higher ed college data, and high school data. But eventually the concept is to try to get human services data in here also and health data. We're not there yet, but the idea is to ultimately get there too.
All right, back to the commissioner, and I'm not going to rush you, but.
No, I think we took a lot of your time.
Some think we're going to get out early today.
Mm-hmm. Chairman, we're done.
Oh, okay.
And I just want to offer any specific questions. We'd love, Ms. Oliver, we'll get you the information somehow, and we'll do the best we can to tell you what's going on, and as we know, at least.
We've had a lot of good questions already, but if there's some other questions that people need to ask, now is the time. I want to thank you, Commissioner, and your staff. This has been a lot of information, and I think for some, at least, we find out your job is more than just giving out money to state grant programs. Pretty involved. So
it is, although, Mr. Chairman, I want to say most of the money is that.
I understand. And while I have a chance, thanks to the audience that comes here and watches this informative hour or two. If there are no other questions, again, I just want to thank you, Commissioner, and your staff, and for everyone else that's here today, we are adjourned.